Welcome, everyone. I'm Pastor Dana, and I invite you all today as we worship together at Brook Hill United Methodist Church. We're glad you're here. We're just excited to connect to God. Our series this week is about life hacks, ways to make life better, especially doing things God's way. And today we're talking about prayer, wireless connection, and we will spend time today connecting to God. So sit back, be at peace, and prepare to talk to our God who loves us.
But you are good and your mercy enduring forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy enduring forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. From generation to generation, we worship you.
Good morning. I'm Sherry Seek, Office Administrator at Brook Hill. I'm glad you could join us for worship this morning. Will you pray with me? Lord, we long to pray with boldness. We have felt threatened and harassed by the troubles that rule these days. We long to change our worlds inside and out. Shake us out of our complacency and our ruts. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, rushing wind. Come, passionate flame and comforter. Rouse us to speak your praise wherever we may be. The Lord is mighty to save. Amen.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, kindness. goodness of a Savior, the hope of nations. A Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. My Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever offer us salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. I'm singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. My Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. My Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever offer us salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Are there any kids out there? Hurry up! It's time for the children's message. Come check it out!
Hi, how are you? I wanted to talk to you today about our lesson today. You're going to hear mentioned in our lesson today the Holy Spirit. And I thought you might not know what that is. So I thought I'd try to explain it to you. When I was a kid, my dad explained it like this. So there's water, there's ice, and there's steam. And all of those things are from water, but they're different forms, right? Well, that's like God. God is the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And when we ask Jesus to live in our heart, He does. He goes in there and He lives in there in the form of the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit, if He's inside of us, helps us do amazing things. One of the things we're called to do is to share our faith boldly. Now, how can we do that? Can we invite people to church? Yes. Can we talk to people about God? Yes. I have a way that I do it. I wear this shirt. Now, you know my favorite scripture is I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Well, I have this t-shirt, and I wear this t-shirt a lot of places. I wear it to the grocery store. I wear it when I'm going to the doctor, or anytime I'm out and about and all around. And people stop sometimes and ask, oh, where did you get that lovely shirt? That's such a nice shirt. Or what does that mean? And then I can share my faith. I can say, this is a scripture, and it's from the Bible, and those are God's words, and that's how I get through my day, every day, because I have His words. Remember last week we learned, thy word have I hid in my heart, that I will not sin against thee, right? Well, this week we're talking about Jesus living in our heart and the Holy Spirit. Now, I'm going to show you a very cool experiment to do. And if you want, you could do it at home too. You just need to ask your parents to help. I just had a plate, some milk, some food coloring, and some dish soap.
You're going to very carefully pour some milk on the plate. The plate is like our world. And then you'll add some drops of food coloring. That's like all the people in the world. Now we're going to try to share the gospel.
So there's the world with the people. And we're going to try to share God's word with the people. It works, sort of, doesn't it? But when we add in the Holy Spirit, what happens? Whoa, look at that. Look how much more colorful it is. Look how the word just spreads all around, everywhere. So when we have the Holy Spirit inside of us, we can be bold in our faith. We can share our faith. It's beautiful, isn't it? Wasn't that cool? What did you think about that? When we tried to share our faith without the Holy Spirit, it sort of worked. But boy, when we added the Holy Spirit, it worked amazingly. That's how it is. If God is in your heart and you're sharing your faith, it comes through loud and clear. People can really hear the message. So I'm going to invite you to share your faith with your friends and your family. You can even share this video with them so they know what we're talking about. I look forward to seeing you next time. You have a wonderful week.
Our children should not think our faith is a Sunday thing, but a daily walk with Jesus.
Good morning. It's time for us now to come before the Lord with our praises, with our thanksgivings, and with our prayer requests. And we want to share several needs this morning. First of all, it's with great sadness that we share with you that Jeff True passed away this last Wednesday, and we want to remember certainly his wife Carolyn and their daughters Sarah and Amy at this time, and all of the family in this time of great sorrow and great loss. And this is truly a loss for many of us here at Brook Hill as well. Secondly, Peggy Kaplan's sister-in-law Lee has passed away after a number of days of physical difficulty, so we want to remember Peggy's family in the death of her sister-in-law. Sam Holter had heart catheterization on Wednesday, and he is doing well. Nathan Collins' father, Terry, has come out of the hospital and gone into hospice care, so we want to remember Nathan and his family and his dad, Terry, at this time. Peggy Nazelrod continues to be hospitalized, but she is doing well. Addison Biggs is recovering well from foot surgery. So let's come and pray together. Father in heaven, how good it is to come to you. We thank you for your welcome to come. We thank you for your open ear, that your face is turned toward us, and that you welcome us to come to you with praises and with thanksgiving and to bring our requests and let them be made known to you. And so we thank you for this opportunity today. Thank you, Father, for this good day and for the strength that you give to us, for the encouragement, for your provision and protection for us. And we pray that you'd help us to live as faithful children of yours, brothers and sisters in Christ, in your family together in these days. Father, we lift up before you these folk who we have mentioned, and we bring them by name before your throne of grace. Jeff and his wife Carolyn and Sarah and Amy, we pray that you'd be with them particularly in this time of great loss. Lord, in their time of grief, watch over them. And as well, Peggy Kaplan's sister-in-law, Lee, her family, Lord, we bring them to you. This is a time as well of great loss, a tragic loss in this family. Strengthen them and help them in these days of sorrow. We lift up Sam and Nathan Collins' father, Terry, and his family, and Peggy and Addison. And we lift up to you as well now others who are in our hearts or on our minds, either silently or aloud. We lift them to you now. Father, how good you are, and we thank you that when we bring these before you, we are not just beating the air, that you are listening and hearing and responding to our prayers. And we pray, Father, for your provision for all of these things that we seek this morning. And we pray together the prayer that the Lord Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
His praises. One day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, what example is he? Word became flesh, light shined among us, His glory revealed, living He loved, dying He saved, buried He carried my sins far away, rising He justified, freely forever, one day He's coming, oh glorious day. Oh, glorious day, glorious day. One day they led up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is He. Hand that healed nations, stretched out on a tree, and took the nails for me. Living He loved, dying He saved, buried He carried. rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Glorious day. One day the grave could conceal Him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then He arose, so the death He had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord, evermore. Death could not hold Him. Grave could not keep Him from rising again. Living He loved, dying He saved, buried He carried our sins far away. Rising He justified freely forever. One day He's coming. Glorious day, oh glorious day, glorious day. One day the trumpet will sound for His coming. One day the skies with His glories will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one, bringing my Savior Jesus is mine. And living He loved, dying He saved, buried He carried my sins far away. Rising He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, glorious day, oh glorious day.
Good morning. We invite you into this holy time of tithes and offerings. Let us prepare our hearts to give with joy and gladness. God loves a cheerful giver. Will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we come to the throne with humble hearts as we are so thankful for the blessings You give us daily. Father, I pray that as we give You our offerings and tithes this morning, that we all think about the fact that it's already Yours, and we wouldn't have it if it wasn't for You. And for that, we say thank You. Please accept this offering and tithes as we give them to You with joy and with gladness. We ask that You bless the givers and bless the ones that wanted to give, and again, bless this offering. We praise Your holy name, and we all say amen.
The scripture this morning comes from the book of Acts, chapter 4, verses 23 through 37. On their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. Sovereign Lord, they said, You made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of Your servant, our father David. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth rise up and the rulers band together against the Lord and against His anointed one. Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city to conspire against Your holy servant Jesus, whom You anointed. They did what Your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable Your servants to speak Your word with great boldness. Stretch out Your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of Your holy servant, Jesus. After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in all of them that there were no needy persons among them. From time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales, and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone who had a need. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold a field he owned and brought the money and put it at the apostles' feet. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Now, I don't know how to say this, but I have a love-hate relationship with my phone. Yeah, it's great to have a wireless device that can always make calls and find information when I need it, where I need it. However, it's also a little bit annoying to sometimes. I'm old enough to remember being a kid before we had mobile devices, and it was kind of nice being unreachable sometimes. We didn't have to stress out about being unconnected or having to respond to messages all the time. But now we stress out when we are in an area without coverage or we can't seem to get enough bars. That said, wireless technology can be great, and it is essential during social distancing. But it's not perfect. We also may have started to notice that it's not a substitute for person-to-person connections. You could call out, and you can receive messages, but does it change anything in our lives beyond that? Is there something more that we long for in our wireless connections? Can we have God in our phone's contact list? In today's scriptures, we pick up after Peter and John were released from custody for allegedly healing and teaching in Jesus' name. They have been let off with a warning not to do that, and immediately they return to the fledgling church, at which point we immediately are caught up in the spirit of prayer. And this is a prayer unlike what most of us might pray normally. It starts out by proclaiming God as creator and ruler, invoking the legacy of David. Then they include verses from Psalm 2, 1 through 6, asking, "Why do the nations and the rulers of this world rebel against God?" Then they proclaim the death of Jesus before asking God to do something, saying, "Now, Lord, consider the threats and enable your servants to speak your mighty word and with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant, Jesus." They ask God to specifically embolden them to do the very thing they had been warned not to do, to speak and heal in Jesus' name. And after they prayed, the entire house began to shake violently. Now, was that God's cell phone going on vibrate? Does that mean that the message sent was sent and received? Get ready for boldness and grace to upload in 10 seconds. Look for the bar that says buffering. Or was that shaking the divine equivalent of buffering itself? This account, like so many in the Bible, highlights the central importance of prayer. We pray and worship together, and hopefully we all have our prayer practice at home as well. We pray for ourselves, our friends, our family, and we may pray for the world. Prayer is, in many ways, our wireless connection between ourselves and God. It can be as long and poetic as you can craft it, or it can be as short and as simple as saying, "Hey God, I need you." But sometimes I have to confess that I wonder why we don't feel the room start to shake more often when we pray. What is it that is supposed to happen when we pray? I mean, I know that sometimes the answer to prayer presents itself in less dramatic ways, but it would be sometimes kind of something to see the earth move, even a little. Where is the boldness in the connection? Do we not have enough bars? Are we in a dead zone or something? Nah, God does not have a dead zone, and God's grace always has full bars. I think the connection problem is not on God's side, it might be on ours. One distinction in the prayer from our lesson this morning is that the people are praying for the church. They pray to be committed to boldness in their faith, reaching out beyond themselves. They said, "Enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness." They offered themselves to become the connection between God and other people. They offered to become a living signal booster for God's message. That shaking that they felt that day, that was the 3G connection linking up to them: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. He was synchronizing with them, with the community, to spread good news and healing in Jesus' name. This prayer was a prayer of connection. They were connecting the church with God and God's message, to connect it to the nations and the world around them with God's message again. And the miraculous thing about this prayer, it was not the shaking of the house. The miracle was what came after. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord. And God's grace was so powerful at work in them all that there were no needy persons among them. Now just think about those few sentences for a moment. All the believers were of one heart and mind. They shared everything they had, and power to testify to the resurrection of Christ, and that grace was so powerful that no one was needy among them. Now, from a pastor's perspective, that sounds like a miracle, especially that part about being of one heart and one mind. Try asking everyone where they want to eat for lunch and see how of one heart and one mind we all are. But all that transforming grace in the early church, it was communicated through the church that it affected everyone around them. And all seemingly after a prayer to God for boldness in speaking about Jesus. I wish I could lead us all in such a prayer today. I wish the entire Methodist Church could pray such a prayer today. In fact, I wish that every church could pray such a prayer. A prayer that connects us with God and each other. A prayer that gets the signal that God is trying to send to us today. A bold prayer that could make us messengers of God's grace and instruments of healing in Christ's name. Perhaps we still can. Maybe we can pray for the boldness of faith, a faith that speaks the good news and seeks to transform someone else's life, a bold faith that holds nothing back from those in need, but shares and shares alike, a faith that lets God reach out through us to heal anyone in arm's reach of the church. The wireless connection that we have with God and each other is a strong connection that does more than make us feel good. It is a connection that changes lives and changes the world. Suppose we have the boldness to connect ourselves to Christ, the living Word. Let's try to make a connection right now. Let's pray. Living God, communicator of love, healer of our lives, our world still rages with nations that struggle and powers that don't want to hear what you have to say. Make your church a bold people once again, willing to listen to your word and broadcasting it near and far, reaching out with a healing hand so that all may feel your saving touch. Help your church to signal grace and love in the name of Jesus boldly. In your name, amen. Well, I guess I got to go make a call. Maybe we all do. Let's call God together later. Amen.
This time of desperation, all we know is doubt and fear. There is only one foundation. We believe. We believe. This broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. Greater than the songs we sing, and in our weakness and temptations, we believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit. And He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And He's coming back again. Let the lost be found. Let the dead be raised. In the here and now, the love in vain. Let the church live now. Our God will save. We believe. And the gates of hell will not prevail, for the power of God is on the veil. Now we know your love will never fail. We believe, we believe. 2, 3. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit. And He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back, he's coming back again. He's coming back again. We believe, we believe.
As we prepare to go out into the world to be the church, I encourage anyone who would like to, tonight we are at 6:30 having a concert of prayer. It'll be in this sanctuary live with social distancing and mask. It'll be a time to really go before, we're calling it broken before the throne, a time to go before the Lord and just to seek God's face. So you're invited to come. Now, as you go out, we pray that you will be bold in your praying, that you will reach out and listen to God and then respond to what God calls you to do. And you can do that in the power of the Holy Spirit. Go forth now in the peace and the grace of Christ Jesus. Amen.